Good morning. Today we're going over our first homework assignment for our chapter on chemical equations. And this one covers simple classifying and simple balancing of chemical equations. So let's get started. In the first case, we're given a reaction with calcium sulfate reacts with aluminum chloride to form calcium chloride and aluminum sulfate. And the first thing they want to know is how do we balance this? And when we do balance it, what number is going to go right here in front of the calcium sulfate? So let me just draw this out here. We can go over this. Calcium sulfate plus aluminum chloride goes to form calcium chloride plus aluminum sulfate. Okay, so the point of balancing is to make sure that you have the same number and type of elements or atoms on each side. So, like I've got one calcium here, one calcium there that's currently balanced. One sulfate here, I can balance that as a group because the whole sulfate doesn't change. I don't have to independently balance sulfur and oxygen atoms. So, one sulfate here, but three sulfates there. So, in order for this to be balanced, I've got to put a three in front to indicate that by having three calcium sulfate molecules, I will have enough sulfates to account for the amount of sulfates in the aluminum sulfate molecule in the product. I say molecules, but it's really a formula unit because this is an ionic compound, right? Now, by having three calcium sulfates, that gives me three calcium ions, which means we must have three calcium chlorides in order to have that balanced. And then, because that gives me a total of six chlorine ions, I'm going to need to put a two in front of here so that that will represent a total of six chlorines. And that gives me two aluminums, which sure enough I have. So this is balanced. Three of these plus two of these will give me three of those plus one of these. And of course, these are not discrete molecules, but this is the ratio, the whole number ratio of each of these individual units that I'm going to get. This is because atoms cannot be created or destroyed in chemical reactions, and these things come together in predictable ways. Calcium has a charge of plus two, chlorine has a charge of minus one. This is the correct formula for calcium chloride. I've got to take that into account. And anything else I can solve by balancing. So they want to know what is the coefficient that goes in front of the calcium sulfate, and we're going to say, hey, that's a three. We want the lowest whole number ratio. Now we put a three in front of there. What should go in front of the CaCl2? Well, that was here, a three, as we showed. And once we've got those, what is going to go in front of the AlCl3? We determined that that had to be a 2. Just like that. Next, they just want us to tell whether these reactions are balanced or not. So one sulfur, two oxygens on the left, one sulfur and three oxygens on the right, that is not balanced. Two aluminums and six chlorines on the left. That's two aluminums and six chlorines on the right, so that appears to be balanced. Two hydrogens and two oxygens on the left. Two hydrogens and one oxygen on the right, that is not balanced. And for part D, I have three carbons on the left, three carbons on the right. Eight hydrogens on the left. Four times two is eight hydrogens on the right. Five times two is 10 oxygens on the left, and that's six from here, and four from there adds up to 10. So that is a balanced equation. Now we need to balance these and then put in the coefficients as comma separated values. So we're going to balance this, and let me just do this over here. If I've got calcium plus bromine goes to form CaBr2. For the moment, I'm going to ignore this phase information that's included. And I see one calcium plus one Br2 gives me one CaBr2, so it's just one, one, and one. Next, I have P4 plus O2 goes to form P4O10. So my phosphorus is currently balanced, but I have 10 oxygens on the right, so I'm going to need five times two would give me 10 oxygens on the left. So that gives me coefficients of 1, 5, and 1. And notice here that I don't have to put the 1 here in front of the P4 or the 1 in front of the P4O10. That is implied by not having anything there. For part C, I have Sb2S3 plus HCl goes to form SbCl3. plus H2S. And then we've got two SBs on the left, so we're going to need two SbCl3s on the right in order for those to be balanced. Three sulfurs on the left, so I'm going to need three H2Ss on the right in order for that to be balanced. And that gives me a total of six chlorines, so I'm going to need six HCls. That gives me six H's, and I see on the right I have six H's, so that is balanced. 1, 6, 2, 3 should be the coefficients there. It is very likely that your equations will be slightly different from my equation, so obviously don't copy and paste what I'm doing, but follow the process that I'm using. So next we've got Fe2O3 plus C goes to form Fe plus CO, and we find that if I have Fe2O3 on the left, I'm going to need two Fe's on the right. O3 on the left means I'm going to need three COs on the right. And if I have three COs on the right, that means I'm going to need three Cs on the left. So that should be 1, 3, 2, 3, and everything will be balanced. This question just has more of the same. So if we go through here, Li3N goes to form Li plus N2. Then we can see with three lithiums on the left-hand side, I'm going to need a three on the right-hand side in order to balance that. And with two nitrogens on the right-hand side, I'm going to need two Li3Ns on the left-hand side. Now that changes the lithium, which I had already balanced. Now I've got six, so I'm going to need six on the right-hand side. So two Li3Ns go to form six Li's plus one N2. So that should be 2, 6, 1. Next, magnesium plus nitrogen goes to form Mg3N2. And if I have one magnesium on the left and three magnesiums on the right, I'll need a three in front of the magnesium symbol on the left in order for that to be balanced. And then it appears I've got two nitrogens on both sides, so that one is done. That's just going to be 3, 1, 1. Next, if I have magnesium Mg plus H3PO4 goes to form Mg3PO42 plus H2. One magnesium on the left, three on the right, so I'm going to need a three in front of that magnesium. H3PO4, again, this is where I've got an entire polyatomic ion. I can just balance the whole thing together. Two phosphates on the right, meaning I'm going to need two H3PO4s on the left. And that gives me six hydrogen atoms on the left, so I'm going to need three hydrogen molecules on the right to get six hydrogen atoms. So that gives me 3, 2, 1, 3. Next, if I have Cr2O3 plus H2 goes to form Cr plus H2O, then I'll start with the Cr. I have two Crs on the left, so I'm going to need two in front of that Cr on the right. O3 on the left, so I'm going to need three H2Os on the right. And that gives me six H's on the right, so I'm going to need three H2s to give me six H's on the left. So 1, 3, 2, 3. Next we have Al plus Cl2. Goes to form AlCl3. So at first it appears that aluminums are balanced, but I have two Cl's on the left and three on the right. The easiest way to balance these will be to go for the lowest whole number ratios. So swap those numbers, and I have three Cl2s will give me the same number of chlorines as two Cl3s. That changes the number of aluminum atoms on the right, so I'm going to need to put a two in front of the aluminum on the left in order to make that work. So that will be 2, 3, 2. And last one here, I have MgCl2 plus AgNO3 goes to form MgNO32 plus AgCl. And starting with the Mg on the left, I have one there and one on the right. Two chlorines on the left, so I'm going to need two AgCls on the right. one silver here, but two on the right, so I'm going to need two AgNO3s to balance that. That gives me two nitrates, and I already have two nitrates, so 1, 2, 1, 2 will be the coefficients there. So here, they're giving us an equation, they're describing it to us, and we just need to come up with the symbolic notation to express that and the balanced part of that. So O3 is formed by the action of solar radiation on O2. So we have O2 is the reactant, and O3 is the product, because O3 is formed when the radiation acts on O2. Now to balance that, O2 going to form O3. This is, again, lowest common multiple. Three O2s will go to form two O3s. So we need the whole chemical equation. So we're going to have three O2s going to form two O3s. Which of these following is a balanced chemical equation? In the first case, two H's, two H's. Two O's on the left, only one O on the right, so it's not that one. In the second case, I have a total of four H's on the left and only two on the right, so that's not balanced. In our third equation, I have two nitrogens on the left, two on the right, four hydrogens on the left, four on the right, and three oxygens on the left, and one plus two is three oxygens on the right, so that looks pretty good. Let me check this last one, though. Two K's on the left, two K's on the right, two H's on the left, two H's on the right, two carbons on the left, only one carbon on the right, so that's not balanced. So it definitely is this ammonium nitrate goes to form dinitrogen monoxide plus two waters. Next, we're looking at this balanced equation, and looking forward statement is not true. So the equation as balanced says we have one sodium sulfate, Na2SO4, plus one barium chloride, that's BaCl2, goes to form two NaCls, and that's two sodium chloride, that's NaCl, and one barium sulfate, that's BaSO4. Additionally, we see that the sodium sulfate and the barium chloride and the sodium chloride are all aqueous, and the barium sulfate product is a solid. So first off, the coefficient of sodium sulfate is one, that's true. Next, 2NaCl could be correctly written as Na2Cl2. No. We always express ionic compounds as the lowest whole number ratio of ions, so that's NaCl. And the coefficient 2 indicates the ratio of NaCl formula units to the other things in that equation. So you cannot multiply that through and put that in the subscript. The products are barium sulfate and sodium chloride. Barium sulfate is solid, that's what that little S is. And barium chloride is dissolved in water. That is what that little AQ means. Next, we're looking at this reaction and determining what is not true. And the reaction says that calcium carbonate solid at 825 degrees Celsius decomposes to form calcium oxide and calcium dioxide. The dioxide is a gas. The calcium oxide and the calcium carbonate are both solid. So first of all, is the reaction balanced? Well, we've got one calcium on each side, one carbon on each side, and a total of three oxygens on each side. Yes, that's true. The products are a solid and a gas. Yes, that's true. The reactant must be heated for the reaction to occur. Yes, that's what they're doing. There are no solutions used in this reaction. That's true. This is solid, solid, and gas. There's no aqueous solution. And finally, water must be present for this reaction to occur. I don't see water listed anywhere in this reaction, so that would be the one that is not true. Next, which is an example of a precipitation reaction. A precipitation reaction, you have two aqueous solutions which come together and they form at least one precipitate. The aqueous reactants are given by this AQ, and the solid product is given by little s. So in this first case, I have aqueous solution decomposes to a liquid and a gas, so that's not true. In the second case, I have two aqueous solutions combined to form an aqueous solution plus a liquid water, so that's not precipitation. In the third case, I combine an aqueous solution with a solid to form another aqueous solution and a gas, so that's not precipitation. The fourth reaction, I have two aqueous solutions come together to give me a solid and another aqueous solution. So that's the precipitation because I have a solid product. In this last example, I have a liquid plus a gas forms a solid, but that's not two aqueous solutions coming together. So note on this one, I didn't even have to look at what was reacting and what the products were. I just had to look at the phases to see what one was a precipitation reaction. In this next case, we're classifying these as precipitation, acid base, or redox. And precipitation forms the solid precipitate. Acid base is actually going to form liquid water. And redox will do neither of those two things, but you'll see change in charge. So in the first case, we have two aqueous solutions come together, and I get an aqueous solution and a solid. So that is precipitation. For part B, I have a solid and a liquid going to form a solid, and it looks like I have elemental bromine and elemental aluminum combining to form aluminum bromide. Since these are neutral, they have a charge of zero, and this is an ionic compound. These have ionic charges. That makes this a redox reaction. And finally, I have two aqueous solutions coming together to form liquid water and another ionic compound, which is dissolved. So that is a acid-base neutralization. The formation of which one of the compounds below acts as a driving force for acid-base reaction? We said the product is going to be liquid water. And because it is liquid, then that is the driving force for the acid-base reaction. Finally, which reaction is an example of both a precipitation and a neutralization? That means we're looking for liquid water as a product to indicate neutralization and a solid product to indicate precipitation. So in the first case, I have aqueous and water liquid. That is a neutralization, but not a precipitation. In the second reaction, I have a solid and a liquid in the product, liquid water and solid barium sulfate. That came from mixing two aqueous solutions together. So that looks like it's it. In this next case, C plus O2 goes to form two COs. That looks like a oxidation reaction. In the fourth case, I'm making two gases and a liquid, so that's not what we're looking for. And in the last case, I get a solid and an aqueous solution, so I don't form water. This is just a precipitation reaction. That's it, guys. I hope this was helpful. Have a great day.